Hi guys, welcome to another session of RBI 24/7. Guys, my name is Mansi Anand and I am here to discuss 5 questions that can be of use to you if you are preparing for competitive exams. So guys, we take up these topics from current affairs or we take up topics from finance and economics current affairs or the topics which are mentioned by students in the comments in which they are facing difficulties, right? So let's not waste any time and move straight away to question number 1. But before doing that, I would like to ask you guys to subscribe to our channel. So if this is the first video of our channel that you are watching, then do not forget to hit the subscribe button. And you can also press this bell icon which is flashing on the screen. It can help you to get notified whenever a new video comes up. Apart from that, you can also join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries and we'll try to take them up as soon as possible. Apart from that, you can also mention your doubts on the videos in the comments and we'll try to resolve them, right? So here is your question number 1. Okay, this question says, following are some statements about a term called beta in finance. Which of the following statement is or are not correct in regard to beta, right? So 3 statements given to you about beta and you have to select the incorrect ones. So if you're not aware of this concept, if you have not heard about this term called beta, which we talk about in finance, then it is perfectly fine because we are going to discuss about it, right? Guys, you can watch, you can pause the video here and give these statements a thorough look and then decide with your answer, right? Okay, moving ahead to the solution, and the correct option for this question is D. D means only 2 is incorrect, 1 and 3 are correct, right? Now, first of all, let us understand that what is the meaning of this term beta. Beta tells you that what is the risk parameter of a particular stock or share of a particular company in relation to the factors which affect the entire market. Basically, it tells you about that if there are some factors that are going to affect the entire market, then how much will this particular company, will this particular investment get affected with those risk factors, right? So if we talk about COVID-19, so COVID-19 affected the economy, the industry at large, but obviously some sectors were too much affected by this, but many sectors were not that much affected. For example, FMCG, fast moving consumer goods, or pharma sector, they were not too much impacted by the impact of COVID-19, right? Whereas if we talk about automobile sector, or if we talk about leisure services, let's say the entertainment industry or aviation or hospitality, they were like the most severely affected companies, affected sectors by COVID-19, right? So beta tells you about this risk factor, not the individual factors of the company, not the individual factors of a particular industry that affects one industry, but it tells you about that what is the change that is going to be in a particular company stock if there occurs any risk that can affect the entire market, right? So this is what beta is all about. So if we talk about company specific factors, let's say there is a company, just as Yes Bank fiasco happened, right? So there were some problems going on in Yes Bank from past few years. So beta is not going to tell you that. It is not going to talk about the individual company's risk factors, but yes, it is going to tell you that whatever the risk is going to affect the entire market, what will be the company's stock sensitivity towards that market risk, right? I hope now you are clear with it. Let us see some details about beta. Okay. Measure the volatility of an individual stock compared to the systematic risk of an entire market. So this is the keyword, systematic risk, a risk which affects the entire system, not only one company, not only one industry, but the entire system, right? It is used to help investors understand whether a stock moves in the same direction as the market or not. So if majority of the market is going up, what is going to be the movement of this particular company in which you want to invest? That is going to be known with the calculation of beta for that company, right? So direction, whether it moves in the same relation as market or whether it goes against the market. For beta to provide any useful insight, market that is used as a benchmark should be related to that of the stock. So if we want to analyze the performance of market, usually we take parameters like Sensex or Nifty, or if you want to go international, you might take S&P 500. So these are some stock indices which are used as an indicator of market performance, right? So if let's say if you are talking about a company, then that company should be in relation to this particular index, because see, you are going to calculate the performance of the company in relation to the performance of market, and the performance of market is going to be told by these factors, right? So basically there should be a correlation between them. It should not happen that the company is entirely a different company that is totally different from the calculation of Sensex or Nifty or whatever parameter you are using as market benchmark, right? Then only the calculation of beta is going to be useful, right? So just as Nifty measures top 50 companies, Sensex measures top 30 companies. If you are going to calculate, let's say, beta of a penny stock, of a junk stock, and then compare it with the performance of these indices, it might not be a great comparison, because it takes into account big companies and you are going to calculate the beta of a penny stock or a junk stock, right? So there should be some relationship between them. Then only beta is going to provide you with some useful insight. So if a stock has beta of 1, it indicates price activity is strongly correlated with market. Then if beta is equal to 1, that means stock is going to move in the same direction as the market. So if market goes up, stock goes up. Whereas market goes down, stock goes down, right? And if beta is more than 1, that means whatever factor is going to impact the market, your stock will be impacted more than the market, right? So if there is a price change of, let's say, 10% in market, if the market falls by 10%, then probably the stock is going to fall more than by 10%, right? And beta is less than 1, that means less sensitivity towards market, right? So this is how calculation of beta can be useful, right? Going back to the statements, here you can see the statements. Beta is a measure of volatility, that is systematic risk. That is why it is the correct statement. Data about an individual stock can only provide an investor with an approximation of how much risk stock will add to diversified portfolio, right? We are going to calculate its risk in relation to the market risk, and that is why it tells us about how much risk this particular stock is going to add if you invest some proportion of your investment into a particular stock. That is why this is also correct. This statement is not correct, because beta tells you about systematic risk. It is not a measure of unsystematic risk, but systematic risk. So I hope this explanation is clear to you. Moving ahead to question number 2. Here is question number 2, which says, what does it refer to? Two statements given to you. You have to tell what is it? What is the meaning of it in these two statements? Simple enough. Moving ahead to the solution. And the solution says that the correct option is cyber insurance. Now, we all know what insurance is. You make some small payments at regular time intervals, and whenever something bad happens or whenever you are in some sort of loss, the insurer pays you back for the amount which has already been mentioned in the terms and conditions of the insurance contract, right? So this is basically a simple concept of insurance. Now we talk about cyber insurance. Cyber insurance protects you against the risk which can be on the platform of internet, such as loss of important material or loss of some confidential data, right? So if you are a business and you are handling the data of your clients, and let's say there is some problem with your systems or your systems get hacked, in that situation you are obviously losing some data, and your client might react to this breach of confidentiality. So in that case, if you need to compensate the client, you need an insurance which can pay you in that particular time. So basically, cyber insurance protects you against the risk of hazards that can happen on internet. Used to protect businesses and individuals, providing services for such businesses from internet based risk. So whatever are the internet based risk, and if you are a business, if you are an individual and you provide services to other parties, other businesses, in that case you are going to be protected by cyber insurance. Can be customized to help company mitigate specific risks relating to information technology, infrastructure, information privacy and other risks, right? Simple enough. Okay, see, the problem here is in India the penetration of cyber insurance is not very much, and as we are moving towards a digital economy, as most of our processes are getting digitized or automated, and I think the outbreak of COVID-19 has given a much required boost to the digital infrastructure, right? But the problem associated with this is that the risks of online thefts, online data theft or breach of confidentiality, so these things are also happening and we need a protection against them. So that is why cyber insurance needs to be boosted. So provides coverage against cyber attack. I think we have discussed all these points in brief. Let's just go through them quickly. Helps customers protect their data against potential breaches and reduce the impact of losses in case any important information is stolen. In general, cyber insurance covers financial losses due to fraudulent use of bank accounts. So if your bank account details are misused and you, let's say you lose your credit card or debit card and someone uses it and steals some money from your account, in that case this can be useful. Also offers cover for ransomware attacks or cyber extortion. If someone is blackmailing you online, then also you can get help from here. Email spoofing, phishing, ransomware attacks which are meant to harm people at a large scale, right? So protection against this also. Adoption of cyber insurance not merely high, but it should be boosted as we are facing a rise in digital transactions. Covers expenses related to defense and legal costs. Obviously, if there is a case against you, let's say you have lost some of your client's data, or if you need to file a case against someone, then some types of insurance can also cover legal costs. Cyber stalking, restoration cost to retrieve or reinstall data. So if you need to retrieve the data and you have to spend some money on it, this insurance can cover that too. Some policies also provide coverage for expenses related to counseling. So let's say someone has been going through some sort of cyber extortion or some sort of cyber bullying, and then they need counseling to come out of that particular trauma that they have been facing. In that case, if they need counseling, some types of insurance also cover that sort of medical costs. Some policies also cover third party consequences. Third party means if any other party is harmed because of any breach, any attack that has happened on your systems, right? Cyber insurance. Moving ahead to next question. This is the third question, which says market regulators SEBI on 18 December 2020 gave certain relaxations to Dash in respect of holding of depository receipts issued by the India listed companies. Very simple question. Moving ahead to the solution, correct option is option A. Option A means NRIs or non-resident Indians. So earlier NRIs, they were not allowed to invest into the depository receipts which are issued by India listed companies, but now SEBI has allowed them to invest in these depository receipts with respect to certain conditions that we are going to learn about, right? So guys, in this answer we are going to learn about certain terms that we have already discussed in different sessions. Depository receipt is also a financial instrument. For those who don't know or who are not aware about it, it is a financial instrument that helps a company to raise money from foreign countries without directly issuing shares there, right? So, and in that particular country, it provides an opportunity to investors to invest into other countries' companies' shares or securities, right? So basically, you can understand it as a token which is granted against share of an Indian company in a foreign country, right? So in one session we have discussed about this depository receipts in detail. If you want its link, you can ask for it in the comments. Here you can see the conditions. Okay, NRIs can hold ears issued by Indian companies under the employee stock option schemes, bonus issue, rights issue, and this is what the regulator said. See, if there is a company which is coming out with some stock options for their employees, guys, we have discussed about ESOPs in one of our previous sessions. ESOPs, bonus issue, rights issues, all these terms have already been discussed. So I hope you are familiar with this, and I'm saying it once again that those of you who are not familiar with any of these terms, they can ask for the link in the comments. So, if there is any Indian company which is coming out with a new issue under ESOPs, or they are coming out with some with bonus issue of shares or rights issue of shares, then the depository receipts which are going to be issued against these shares, in those receipts NRIs can invest, right? So not in a normal issue, but if any shares are issued under bonus issue, right issue, rights issue, or employee stock option schemes, then NRIs can invest in it, right? October 2019, SEBI banned NRIs from buying DRs which are issued by India listed companies. And now SEBI is also saying that whichever company is going to get into this issuance of depository receipts, they have the responsibility of identification of those NRI holders. That means they have to maintain a list of their names and their details so that the regulators can know that who are these NRIs who are holding the depository receipts against the shares, right, under the employee benefit scheme. Company would also provide information of such NRI DR holders to designated depository for the purpose of monitoring of limits. This is an explanation of DR. So I hope you're clear with this recent news. Moving ahead. Okay, which statement tells you correctly about the concept of red tapism, right? Five statements given to you, you have to select the correct one. And the correct option for this question is option C, which says red tapism hampers business activities growth in a country. Now, first of all, talking about red tapism concept, right? Okay. Whenever you are starting up a new business, let's say you want to indulge in a startup, let's say your startup talks about growing mushrooms, right? You are fond of mushrooms and you want to open a company in which you are going to provide different varieties of mushrooms to different buyers, right? So this is your startup idea, and you need to if you need to start it, then you need to get a lot of bureaucratic approvals from it, right? You need to get it registered, you need to tell the authorities, and for telling the authorities, there are a lot of documents that you have to submit. Apart from that, there must be form filling of so many at so many departments, and apart from that, you will have to make fee payments at different places, right? So this is a lengthy procedure, and not an easy one, right? So it is not just like going to a department and getting your firm registered. You have to provide a lot of documents, and you have to make a lot of effort, right? So the point here is, if these processes are too lengthy, that hampers the growth of business in an industry, business in a country. So, because see, this is, if the processes are too lengthy and you are waiting for approval for months and you cannot start operating your business, then obviously you are going to get tired one day and you might even quit the idea of coming up with a startup, right? So, for boosting companies, for boosting business activity in the country, red tapism should be controlled, right? So, that is why the correct statement is that business is hampered by red tapism. So, it can also be a measure to disincentivize certain people to enter into certain industries and leave that particular industry to the mercy of certain big players, right? So, especially for smaller players, this is very difficult to fulfill all the regulations, to fulfill all the formalities related, right? So, the easier it is, the more is going to be the growth of business in a country. So, generally includes filing out paperwork, obtaining licenses, having multiple people or committees approve decision, various low-level rules that make conducting one's affairs slower, more difficult, and sometimes expensive also. Right? Usually applied to governments, corporations, and large organizations. Every new scheme gets roadblocked. So this is one reason that why many schemes in a country like India, they are not able to reach to their heights. Because see, the time lag which is there between coming up with the idea, conception of the idea, and starting with the operations, that is very important. If that time becomes too long, the entrepreneur might lose interest in it, or the contractor who is carrying out the scheme, the authorities which are responsible for carrying out a certain project might lose interest in it, or they might run out of financial resources that they have, right? So this is one of the problem that occurs in implementation of many schemes, and it eventually kills the larger objective for which it was launched. This is the reason we may have seen many new schemes being launched by many government and private initiatives, but they do not reach their full scale, right? And a recent study which compared many people, see, there was a study which studied that people who go to out of India or NRI entrepreneurs, if they come back to their country, are they able to start their businesses or start the operations of their businesses in their own country freely or not? So there was a comparison between Indian entrepreneurs and Chinese entrepreneurs who move to foreign and then they come back in their own home country to run their businesses. So China was providing a much conducive environment for the growth of these entrepreneurial activities as compared to India, right? So these formalities are not truly meaningless, because at some point you need to get registered, you need to store data, you need to you need to control, or you need to put these startups, these businesses in compliance with laws. But making them easier, or providing online modes of application, or making the processes faster can help in boosting business, right? So this is red tapism. Moving ahead to last question, this is the last question for today, which says, in India, the central bank is on a spree to buy foreign exchange in order to prevent the appreciation of country's currency. What, according to you, is the fiscal cost for the economy associated with this act? Right? So India is building up huge reserves, huge foreign exchange reserves, and there is a fiscal cost associated with this. What do you think it is? Moving ahead to the solution, correct option is option B. Central bank is replacing high yielding Indian securities with low yielding foreign securities. First of all, let us just try to understand the concept, then we will come back to the statement and the answer. Okay, foreign currency reserves foreign currency holdings of RBI have gone up from 439 billion in early April 2020 to 533 billion at the end of November 2020. Right, so there has been a drastic increase in RBI's foreign exchange reserves, holdings of RBI's foreign exchange reserves in this COVID period, right? So what does it mean? It means that if reserves are increasing, RBI is buying much of foreign denominated assets, or RBI is buying the foreign currency in simple terms. And to buy this foreign currency, obviously they have to make payments in rupees. So they are selling rupee and they are buying foreign currency. So selling rupee, buying foreign currency, usually dollar, right? And why is RBI doing this? RBI is doing this because they want to control the appreciation of Indian rupee. And why is Indian rupee appreciating? Because of the huge capital that has been generated in by central banks all over the world, and that is finding its way to stock markets of emerging economies like India. So there is a lot of liquidity creation around the world to fight the economic impacts of COVID-19, and they are finding their way to Indian stock markets. You can see by the number of deals that have been taking place in recently. So foreign investors are demanding Indian rupee, which is making, so foreign investors demand Indian rupee. Indian rupee appreciates, which makes our exports expensive and might result in reduction of export, right? Exports. So to control this situation, RBI sells rupees, because see, foreign investors, they are demanding rupee, buying rupee denominated assets. To balance that, RBI sells rupee and buy foreign exchange. So this is the reason why US has put up RBI on this is the reason why US has put up India on its watch list. They are thinking Indian central bank is manipulating its currency. We discussed it in a recent session. Okay, and the logic behind this is that RBI wants to control the sudden appreciation of rupee. Right, but see, this is not free of cost. This comes with some cost. And what is that cost? That since RBI is selling rupee into the market, that is increasing the supply of rupee in the market, which is obviously going to put downward pressure on rupee. So increasing supply of rupee. This increased supply of rupee, although puts downward pressures on rupee, but also increases the monetary base in the economy, or it uses too much of rupee into the market, which might lead to an inflation in the coming times. Because see, RBI is infusing too much rupee into the market, right? It might lead to an increase in the monetary base, an increase in the money which is circulating in the market. And if too much money circulates, that leads to inflation. So they need to control that also. For that, they need to perform a transaction which is known as sterilized intervention. This particular transaction is an intervention by RBI, and to control its impact, RBI needs to sterilize it. Then it will be called a sterilized intervention. This topic has also been discussed in a previous video. You can ask for its link if you are not familiar with sterilized intervention. Now, to control this increased supply of rupee in the market, RBI will issue bonds, and these bonds will, RBI is going to issue bonds, and then investors are going to subscribe to these bonds, and RBI is going to suck out liquidity from the economy, excess liquidity from the economy, so that it doesn't lead to inflation, right? So to control this increased supply of rupee, RBI, it sells bonds, and obviously people who subscribe to these bonds provide money to RBI, which reduces the money supply in the market, right? So see, now RBI, if they are selling rupee denominated bonds to suck out excess rupee from the market, they will have to provide some interest on it. And usually the interest rates on these rupee, since India is an emerging economy, interest rates of currencies of emerging economies is high in comparison to currencies of advanced economy. So do you see, RBI, at the end, if we have a look at this total transaction, we see that RBI is buying foreign exchange and in return it has to sell Indian bonds, right? So this sterilized intervention, it comes at a cost, because RBI will have to provide a high interest rate on these rupee denominated bonds or rupee denominated assets, whereas the foreign exchange that it is buying for itself is usually low yielding, because they mostly buy dollars or the currencies of advanced countries which provide interest rates which are near to zero. And these interest rates lately, they have come down because of the COVID impact, right? So that is why we are saying that RBI is buying foreign currency which is going to earn them a lower interest rate near to zero, whereas they are selling high yielding Indian bonds, and on these they would have to provide a higher interest rate. India being an emerging economy, providing higher interest rates than advanced economies, right? So this is kind of a fiscal cost which is associated with carrying out this whole transaction, right? So I hope now you are clear with this topic. Moving back to the statements, the correct option was option B. Central bank is replacing high yielding Indian securities with low yielding foreign securities. This is the cost. They are buying low yielding foreign securities, and to sterilize the transaction, they have to issue high yielding Indian securities. I hope now this particular section is clear to you. Moving ahead to some more details about this. I think we have discussed most of it. Just running through it. Okay, India has seen strong inflows, global capital, increase in liquidity, reserve accumulation is more than enough to cover precautionary motive. So they are saying that this is one problem, that India is getting too much capital and they are not able to make a very good use of this capital into productive sectors. So India is getting more capital than it can accommodate or that it can absorb. We need to absorb this capital in productive sectors. India has enough reserve to protect us in case we have any global shock, or we need to in case we come across a crisis and we need foreign exchange to support us. So India has a lot of foreign exchange for the precautionary motives. Yet central bank will have to increase this reserve to prevent the appreciation of rupee. Holding excess reserves comes at a cost. Replacing high yielding Indian securities with foreign bonds that provide interest rates which are close to zero, right? So this is the fiscal cost. So this comes out of an article in Live Mint. That was an editorial article. So I hope now this is clear. Okay guys, in a recent session we discussed about sandbox, so there was a confusion. Here I have put some pictures of sandbox and hourglass just to mitigate that confusion, right? So this is a sandbox and this is an hourglass. What we discussed in that session was an hourglass. Actually, the correct sandbox looks something like this: a playing area for kids and a testing area for budding entrepreneurs, right? Okay. So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video. If you did, then do not forget to hit the like button, because I'll be back in next session with some new information. And I would like to take some doubts here. Just give me a second. Okay, there was a comment by Evil Surbhi, and she wanted to know that if she can begin with the current videos because she does not have enough time to watch the entire playlist. So according to me, what you can do is just keep watching the current videos, and if you get time, then go to the previous videos. But if you do not get time, what you can do is, just as I mentioned many terms in today's session, And I told you that if you're not aware of certain term, then you can ask for its link. So if you're not aware of a certain term, then you can go back to that entire that previous video or previous session, right? And many times I refer to many terms which have been covered in previous sessions. So in that way, you're going to cover some parts of previous sessions as well. And if you get time, then you can obviously watch the entire playlist as per your time management. Okay. There was a doubt by Pooja, and Pooja says, if one company goes for IPO, then after its listing price, let's say a company goes for an IPO, and then after its price falls, after its listing price falls sharply, how can this sudden fall affect the issuing company, or there would be no impact as it has already raised the money from market? See, financially, there is not going to be much impact, but yes, the promoters who have been holding the shares many times, if you remember, we discussed about a concept called listing pop, that after listing, if the price rises suddenly and many investors, they look to gain in this short time frame, right? So many people there can be many promoters of the company which are holding shares who want to gain out of this listing pop. So they are going to lose money. And in financial terms, there is not going to be much impact on the company, but yes, there is going to be a loss of confidence in investors, and when the company raises money in future, then it might impact it if the prices do not rise and they maintain themselves at low level, right? So I hope it helps you. Okay, one more doubt by Akshita Dixit. Akshita says, why is cost of borrowing low in a serial bond even though the issuer does not have to return the borrowed money in one go? Means that it is more convenient for the issuer. Okay, I agree that it is more convenient for the issuer. But see, usually what happens is, there's an issuing company, let's say X Limited, they issue bonds for 10 years, right? So after 10 years, they would have to make a lump sum payment to redeem the bonds. Whereas there is another company which comes up with a serial issue bonds and starts redeeming some bonds, let's say after 4 years. So obviously it is more convenient for the Y Limited, but it is also convenient for the investors as well, because they start to get money after 4 years, and the loan burden of the company, it gradually starts to reduce. Let's say it makes payment after every 2 years. So it makes payment at the end of 4th year, then at the end of 6th year, at the end of 8th year. So the loan burden is getting reduced gradually. And if the loan burden is getting reduced, the credit risk that Y Limited might not make payment on the redemption of the bonds, that is also getting reduced for the investor. That is why investor might be willing to buy the bonds at a lower interest rate, right? So cost of borrowing becomes less because of the safety, or because of the a gradual reduction in credit risk for the investor. So I hope this is clear to you. Okay, so guys, these were some doubts, and we'll try to cover the rest of the doubts in upcoming sessions. So you stay tuned and keep your studies going on. Take care of your health. I'll see you in the next session. Thank you for being here.